Well, as I said, it's a real pleasure to be here tonight, a little later my time than yours, and I'm going to try to keep the presentation a part of this relatively short so we have some time for questions and answers. So as I assume everyone tuning into this knows, Taiwan is once again a major source of friction and many would say the greatest risk of great power conflict in the world today. We've seen the increase in military activities near Taiwan by the People's Liberation Army and its Air Force and Navy in the last several weeks. We've seen incursions into what Taiwan considers its air defense identification zone, obviously a period of heightened tension. We've seen U.S. foreign policy support for Taiwan reach really unusually high levels by recent historical standards. We've seen statements from the Biden administration, some of the statements from the Trump administration, and Congress passing in the last several years a raft of legislation that can fairly be described as pro-Taiwan or increasing U.S. support for Taiwan. The Economist, a few months ago, dubbed the Taiwan Strait the world's most dangerous place. So I want to suggest that these risks of the moment are real, but they're not yet a crisis, and that the real dangers are more slowly evolving, more accidental, and are deeply rooted in a mixture of international law and international politics. So I'm going to try to do in the brief time here this evening is give you a little bit of a play in five acts. That was act one. The next three acts will be the perspectives on the tangled web of law and politics, from the perspective of the three protagonists in our story, the People's Republic of China, the United States, and Taiwan, and then close with some sense of where we stand and where we're likely to go, what sorts of things to look out for as we move forward. So from China's perspective, the Taiwan problem is a problem left over from history. And there are a bunch of different strands to the PRC argument here, but they are all ultimately rooted in a quite neuralgic, quite painful period in Chinese history, certainly as the PRC views it. Taiwan, as many of you know, was formally transferred from China to Japan as a part of the peace treaty ending the Sino-Japanese War near the end of the 19th century, the Treaty of Shimonoseki. And the Chinese view of this, shared by the nationalists as well as the communists, is that that was an unequal treaty. It was a treaty that was invalid, void ab initio, void from the beginning, because of its substantive unfairness, because of the coercion that was used to extract it through a war, and because it was an impermissible encroachment on China's sovereignty. So in the strongest version of this view, Taiwan never left because Taiwan never could leave. It was an unbreakable, unremovable part of China. The second arrow in the historical argument quiver is that whatever the treaty might have done, it was eliminated by the developments of 1937 when Japan invaded China. On this view, the ceding of Taiwan, if it happened at all, was done as the price of peace. In return, Japan promised peace, and when it invaded China and what would later become the Asia-Pacific part of World War II, Japan abrogated that treaty and Taiwan reverted to China on this view. Next development was the end of World War II, when Japanese forces on Taiwan surrendered to the forces of the Republic of China, that returned Taiwan to China, and on the PRC view, when the Chinese Communist Party won the civil war that followed World War II in China and founded the People's Republic of China in 1949, the PRC succeeded to all of the rights of the ROC in the international order, including sovereignty over Taiwan. And whatever piece of that history one wants to emphasize, by the time we get past 1949, the view consistently from the Chinese side is that there is only one China in the world, and it includes Taiwan. And that China has been represented on the international stage by the government of the People's Republic of China. We just hit the 50th anniversary of UN General Assembly Resolution 2758, the resolution that removed the Republic of China, the government in Taipei, or as the resolution called it, the forces of Chiang Kai-shek, from the UN and passed the Chinese seat, which of course included a seat on the Security Council, to the PRC. And that's been replicated in the years since in many, many high-profile international organizations, including all of the UN-affiliated ones. The Republic of China, Taiwan is shunted aside, and the PRC takes the Chinese seat. On the PRC view, ultimately Taiwan is and can be no more than essentially a province that is the unrecovered remnant of a civil war that except for a handful of places, ended in 1949. And since Taiwan is on this view part of China, China exercises or enjoys a great deal of discretion about how it would choose to exercise its sovereignty over Taiwan, and that is indeed one of the things that makes many people in Taiwan worried. So that's kind of the backstory. If we look at the path ahead, sort of China's agenda, it is one of unification or reunification. This is partly a question of ends and partly a question of means. The end point, of course, is a Taiwan that is in some form back under the exercise of sovereignty from Beijing. So what does this mean? Well, it means no formal independence. That's off the table for Taiwan, no separate statehood. And the moments when leaders in Taiwan have gotten too close to that red line have been moments of prior serious friction in the Cross-Strait relationship. So that's why when a then president in Taiwan, Chen Shui-bian, announced that Taiwan was adopting a new constitution, or at least he wanted to propose a new constitution and then went for constitutional revision, the reason that was so provocative was that although an ongoing country can of course amend its constitution and an ongoing country or state can of course adopt a new constitution, adopting new constitutions is something that newly independent states do. We saw that in the decolonization era around much of the world. We saw it in the aftermath of the breakup of the Soviet Union and some of the Eastern European satellite states, the Soviet Union. So it was a provocative gesture and China didn't much like it. We also saw it when Chen Shui-bian, as he was about to leave office in 2008, put on the ballot in Taiwan a referendum on whether Taiwan should enter the United Nations under the name Taiwan. This, of course, wasn't going to go anywhere, but it was provocative in Beijing's view because in the view not just held by Beijing, but held by many others, the UN is a states member-only organization, so membership implied statehood, and indeed, 2758, the resolution from the early 1970s, we just hit the 50th anniversary of, was one that said there was one China and the question was who held that seat. A separate membership for Taiwan would be problematic. And we see the same concern about deterring or rejecting whiffs or hints of formal independence with China's moves to keep Taiwan out of significant participation in many international organizations and to squeeze Taiwan's diplomatic partners and so on. So the other, so to sort of the Chinese position on this and how to deal with the path ahead is therefore to reject and deter anything that looks like edging close to a formal declaration of independence. China has also passed in 2005 an anti-secession law, interestingly different from a reunification law, and its premise is, like some of my opening remarks here, that Taiwan never left China. It's always been, or at least since some time decades ago, has been part of China. And so any move that would be secession, an attempt to leave China, something which on the Chinese view has not yet happened, would be met with extreme measures, including the use of force. China's position is, of course, to prefer peaceful resolution, peaceful reunification, but it clearly reserves the right to use force if need be, and has signaled that its patience is significant, but not infinite. And so Xi Jinping himself has said that this is a question that cannot be left over from generation to generation, but must be resolved at some point. And the second white paper that China issued on the Taiwan question back in 2000 said that another cause for the use of force, a causus bellum, a trigger for possible war, would be if Taiwan delayed indefinitely on negotiations for return. In the Chinese view, much of what the U.S. and others do is impermissible foreign interference in China's internal affairs. If you view Taiwan as the Chinese equivalent of, say, Florida, then it's problematic if another country, the United States in this case, is selling arms and is indeed stationing some small number of troops there. And of course, it was very much not okay in China's view back in the days when the U.S. maintained formal diplomatic relations and recognized the government of the Republic of China. Ultimately, reunification, on the Chinese view, it's been a view since the 1980s, is that the reunification must occur under some version of the one country, two systems policy that was put in the Chinese constitution in 1982. It was adopted with an eye toward Taiwan, but as a historical accident would have it, it was first applied to Hong Kong and then to Macau, and the way it's been applied in those two places has made it rather unappealing in Taiwan. So that's the backstory. How China views the underlying problem and how it views an acceptable path forward. But we're in a moment of crisis now, and the question, or a moment of relative crisis, at least a bad turn now, and why? And I think there's several factors that feed into this on the Chinese side. One is the view from Beijing and from the mainland in general is that Taiwan has drifted away from the previously shared view that there was one China that included both Taiwan and the mainland. The Republic of China government under the Jiang, certainly under Chiang Kai-shek, very much took that view. It was just a question of getting back the mainland. And the PRC view, of course, is that Taiwan is part of a single China ruled by Beijing. But that drift from that position has accelerated over the years. Li Denghui, then president in Taiwan, the first democratically elected president in Taiwan, dipped a toe or a foot in the water on this, saying that the relations between the mainland and Taiwan were nation-to-nation, or at least a special type of state-to-state relations, by which it's partly international, partly domestic, and that Taiwan, the Republic of China, the government in Taiwan, the Republic of China had been an independent state since the revolution that brought the Republic of China to power, and therefore had no need to redeclare independence. Well, that's a bit of word salad, but it's clearly moving toward a position that suggests separateness from the mainland. And then we had Chen Shui-bian as president frequently referring to the sovereignty of Taiwan. We had Ma Ying-jeou, who was a little more accommodating toward the mainland when he was president in Taiwan, saying there's one China, but we can each have our own interpretation. It's the Yi Zhong Ge Biao position that Beijing found acceptable but not entirely appealing. And of course, under Tsai Ing-wen, we've seen a drift a bit back toward a more distinct and more robustly sovereignty asserting position, where she often uses the discourse to say that Taiwan is a sovereign country whose name is the Republic of China, to keep a little bit of a hook there. That's one thing, the drift of Taiwan away from this one China view that had long been shared. Secondly, there's, I think, a sense in the mainland that the long-cherished goal of peaceful reunification, of persuading people in Taiwan to return to the fold of China, is not really working. Winning hearts and minds has not worked. This is especially the case with the ill odor in which the one country, two systems model is now held in Taiwan because of the events in Hong Kong in the last couple of years, where the sense in Taiwan very much is that that's not a model that Taiwan wants, that it is an indication of what would be lost in terms of democracy, self-governance, and rights if Taiwan were to return to China under that kind of model. There's a generational dynamic to this. The younger generation in Taiwan, who voted heavily for Tsai and her party, refer to themselves as naturally independent, the Tianrandu. And there is a worry on the mainland that although they don't much like Tsai and her positions, that her possible successor, her current vice president, Lai Ching-de, may be even more of a pro-independence type, as Beijing would put it, and that the more appealing or at least more tolerable party on Taiwan from Beijing's perspective, the Kuomintang, the KMT, is in serious trouble and may have a hard time coming back. There's also more pressure mounting on the Chinese side. Xi Jinping is, in the view of many China watchers, someone who sees the Taiwan question as something of a legacy issue. Getting Taiwan back is something he wants to do. And the vision of China as a great power and the achievement of the goal of the great rejuvenation of the Chinese nation is something that, of course, means that lost territories must be recovered. And there's also the view in China that the U.S. and its friends and allies in the region have become more supportive of Taiwan, more interfering in Taiwan's internal, China's internal affairs by their support for Taiwan. And perhaps a sense that the state of China's relations with the U.S. and the West now is sufficiently dire that many of the costs of turning up the pressure on Taiwan are already there. China's not going to be held in less good regard if it increases efforts to push Taiwan towards some kind of accommodation. So that's the relatively long Act Two. Act Three is the U.S. view. The history here is a little shorter and a little less complicated in some ways. The early post-World War II position on the U.S. side was not to really think much about Taiwan. It was outside the initial Cold War defense perimeter. The assumption was that it would go back to a China ruled by the PRC. And then the Korean War, the conflict between the U.S. and China on the Korean Peninsula, changed all that, and the U.S. brought Taiwan more or less within its defense perimeter. And the U.S. began fairly early on in the post-war period to take an agnostic position on the sovereign status of Taiwan, leaving the door open to the view that sovereignty had not really been resolved, but that the U.S. was to some degree, to a significant degree, once the Mutual Security Treaty went into place with the ROC to protect Taiwan against a possible invasion or coercion from China. And the U.S. basically maintained formal relations, fully maintained formal diplomatic relations with the ROC government in Taipei as the government of China until 1979. But over the 1970s, the position got increasingly finessed. When George H.W. Bush was the U.S.'s U.N. ambassador 50 years ago, he tried to broker on behalf of the Nixon administration a dual representation in the U.N. option, which would have given the PRC the China seat, would have allowed Taiwan to remain in some form. Then we got the Shanghai communique shortly thereafter, and the 1979 second communique that accompanied the normalization of diplomatic relations between the U.S. and China, where the U.S. did an interestingly clever dance and basically did not recognize, did not take a position itself, but simply said the U.S. acknowledges that all Chinese on both sides of the strait believe that there is one China that includes Taiwan. And that was consistent with the Taiwanese government's position at the time, but it didn't commit the U.S. to any view on sovereignty or status. Around the same time, of course, the U.S. adopted the Taiwan Relations Act, which remains a fundamental framework for the U.S.'s relations with Taiwan and, in turn, relations with China over the Taiwan question. And what the Taiwan Relations Act does is a bit of a complicated pantomime dance. What it says is that as a matter of U.S. domestic law, we will treat Taiwan pretty much as if it were a state and treat the government in Taipei pretty much as if it were the government of a recognized state, a government with which we maintain formal diplomatic relations. But it's all informal. We don't take a position on statehood. We don't maintain formal diplomatic relations, but only informal ones. We terminate the Mutual Security Treaty, but we maintain a commitment to provide arms of a defensive character, although it's not a terribly binding commitment on the president. But it's, again, a matter of domestic law, not an official international position. The Clinton administration embraced the so-called three no's, which more or less kept in line with prior policies, saying the U.S. did not support two Chinas, or one China, one Taiwan, or independence for Taiwan, or Taiwan's membership in state member organizations like the U.N. That's actually four no's, but they're always counted as three. On the other hand, the U.S. continued to support robust, if informal, international space for Taiwan, its participation in various international organizations, and its enjoyment of what international lawyers call international legal personality. And this includes, again, robust informal relations and membership in non-states member-only organizations. So what's the path ahead on the U.S. here? Well, we've still been grappling with it, as I suggested, but the U.S. position remains one of what one could call cheap agnosticism. That is, that we take the position that any peaceful resolution of the Cross-Strait relationship is fine with us, but that's kind of cheap talk because the belief has been there would be no reunification on peaceful terms that Taiwan would agree to. In practice, the U.S. has maintained a quasi-ally-like tie to Taiwan, and has tried to balance that commitment with interests in good relations, or at least not terribly hostile relations with China. And the policy has been captured in the phrase strategic ambiguity, which is really a policy of dual deterrence. One of trying to deter Taiwan from pushing the envelope on independence and statehood. And when Taiwan has pushed that envelope, relations have taken a turn for the worse. Again, some of the classic bigger examples come from the Chen Shui-bian presidency in Taiwan, when then U.S. President George W. Bush sat down with Chinese Premier Wen Jiabao, and they had a little fireside chat in which Bush told Wen that the U.S. Opposes Chen's seemingly unilateral efforts to change the Cross-Strait status quo, and things became even more pointed when at the time of that referendum that was put to Taiwanese voters in 2008 about whether Taiwan should seek to join the UN under the name Taiwan, the U.S. rebuked Taiwan in an unprecedentedly sharp way, saying your domestic democracy is your business, but when you put out these kinds of referenda that imperil U.S. strategic interests, we will speak up and criticize it. That was a message sent by the Deputy Assistant Secretary of State with responsibility for that part of the world. On the other hand, strategic deterrence, strategic ambiguity is dual deterrence, and the other deterrent is to deter China from trying to coerce a solution, trying to coerce Taiwan into accepting an accommodation, and generally causing crises in the cross-strait relationship. And so in moments when the U.S. has judged China to be at fault, we've seen the U.S. push back. So the 95-96 missile crisis around the time of Taiwan's first democratic presidential elections, the one that kept Lee Teng-hui in office, the U.S. sent ships to the Taiwan Strait area to counter China's missile tests that were meant to threaten Taiwan. And throughout Tsai Ing-wen, the current president's term in Taiwan, the U.S. has been pretty supportive on the view that the current chill and potential crisis and mounting tensions are China's fault, not Taiwan's. The other piece of the U.S. Puzzle here is the values issue. Values issues matter to a degree in U.S. foreign policy, and so there's been an emphasis on democracy and human rights that's waxed and waned over the years, but Taiwan has played to that and has enjoyed support from the U.S. partly for those reasons. Taiwan transformed into a democracy during the waning days of the Chiang Ching-kuo, Chiang Kai-shek's son's regime, and it was seen, I think quite rightly, as a key to keeping U.S. support at a moment when the Cold War was no longer a sufficient reason for alliance and quasi-alliance structures, when the U.S. was improving relations with China that was seen as no longer part of a monolithic communist bloc or even necessarily adversarial country. Taiwan had to find some way to up its stock to keep the relationship going, and so it did so in part through improving its democratic and human rights performance. Now, over the years, this story, which I think has really been quite steady in many ways, has been occasionally upset by noise of one sort or another. Presidents and other senior officials in the United States have strayed off that core position that I've just tried to summarize and the sacred texts of the three communiques, the Taiwan Relations Act, and the six assurances that were issued jointly with the third communique to assure Taiwan that the commitments made in the third communique to reduce arms sales to Taiwan would not mean, in a sense, negotiating with China over Taiwan's fate or lessening the U.S. commitments true to Taiwan. So we've seen these cases, as I said, where essentially officials seem to have changed the policies. George W. Bush famously had one of his senior officials say that the president would do whatever it takes to protect Taiwan. Trump, in his early days and as president-elect heading into being president, said everything is on the table, including the U.S.'s one China policy, which opened the door to saying we might recognize a separate Taiwan, although it didn't happen. And most recently, President Biden on the CNN town hall, when asked if the U.S. would come to the defense of Taiwan, said, yes, we have a commitment to do that. Those are all cases of presidents going in directions that seem to be upsetting the status quo in a way that would support Taiwan more strongly. There are numerous other instances where presidents and senior officials have been criticized for seeming to undercut or reduce the U.S. commitment to Taiwan. And every time that happens, including in the three examples I just mentioned, they scurry back to the safety of saying our fundamental policy, including the One China policy, has not changed. So that's all pretty stable stuff beneath the noise. But I do think we are in a particularly bad moment again right now, and that's partly for, again, some pretty big picture factors. One is the state of the U.S.-China relationship has really, I think, reached a low point, certainly the lowest point since 79, and that has led to a very different view in the U.S. of how to handle Taiwan and cross-strait relations. To put it fairly simply, not too long ago, when the U.S.-China relationship was reasonably good, Taiwan was seen as the most likely cause of an unnecessary and potentially disastrous crisis or conflict in what was basically a good U.S.-China relationship. Now I think the view is the U.S.-China relationship is in trouble. It's in trouble for some very deep reasons, and that if the U.S. were to be maximally accommodating to Beijing on the Taiwan question, it wouldn't fix the relationship. We'd still have trouble, and that indeed, if the relationship continues to deteriorate, Taiwan starts to look like more of a strategic asset, at least as long as Taiwan is not provoking a crisis in cross-strait relations, which it seems very unlikely to do under Tsai, as it was extremely unlikely to do under her predecessor, Ma. There's also a sense of the shifting strategic balance across straits. As China becomes more militarily impressive, more able to contemplate actually taking military action against Taiwan, or at least blockading, then the U.S. longstanding goal of deterring China from coercing Taiwan means that the U.S. has to back Taiwan more strongly to offer assurance and to make stronger commitments that will attempt to deter China from thinking it can act with impunity. This has become all the more imperative, not just because of the shifting balance across the Strait, but also because of the shifting balance as China's power rises relative to that of the U.S., and as doubts have grown in China about how serious the U.S. commitment is. The Trump administration was kind of a proof of concept that the U.S. might walk away from its commitments and its prior policies rather precipitously, but it's a deeper problem than that, rooted in changes in relative power. Add to that the ideological and values dimension, which has become much more core to how the U.S. handles the Taiwan-China-U.S. triangle. Partly, the values issues are just back on the table. That's something the Biden administration has emphasized, criticizing the Trump administration for undercutting U.S. soft power and its commitment to democracy, human rights, and things like that. But also, these ideological issues are part of the glue that is being used to hold together the coalition of allies and near allies that the U.S. is now trying to build along China's periphery. And when that happens, you create something which, although not a Cold War, takes on at least some of those qualities by aligning conflicts of some fairly basic interests with ideological competition and, to a degree, mutual demonization. So now moving on to Act Four, which is the Taiwan side of this. And the Taiwan approach to this has been fairly straightforward in concept and fairly multifaceted in implementation. Basically, for Taiwan, the imperative has been to be as much like a state as it can without crossing China's red lines, and to play to the values issues in international affairs that are always there and that are sometimes comparatively prominent, as they are arguably now. And so there's a piece of the Taiwanese package here which has, for many years, certainly since the 1990s, been to emphasize the ways in which Taiwan looks like a state and has the attributes of a state in the international system. So you will see lots of emphasis on the separate governance. The PRC has never ruled Taiwan. The ROC has ruled Taiwan since 1949. You will see an emphasis on the identity of the people in Taiwan as a distinct identity, their own sense of being Taiwanese rather than Chinese, or at worst Taiwanese and Chinese, and almost none who consider themselves exclusively Chinese. And you see Taiwan emphasizing that, hey, it's an island, it's got a coherent landform, and that Taiwan is actually, by many metrics, a bigger deal on the international stage than are many uncontested, undisputed states. So in terms of population, size of the economy, size of territory, and the maintenance of informal relations with other countries, Taiwan scores pretty darn well. What lurks in the background here are the international legal criteria, which here more or less track the international political criteria for being a state in the international system, and with that comes a degree of security and status. So think of, to take an analogy from recent Middle East history, if Saddam Hussein is going to get violent, wouldn't you rather be Kuwait than the Iraqi Kurds? You want to be a state rather than a part of another state. Where the central government is using coercive measures in a way that the world sees as domestic rather than as crossing boundaries and taking over another state. So Taiwan wants to push in that direction, but there are limits to how far it can push in that direction without provoking China to action or without endangering or at least destabilizing support from the United States. So you see all those phrases I mentioned earlier by Taiwanese presidents that have put sovereignty into the mix, but haven't quite fully declared Taiwan as a fully independent sovereign state separate from China, full stop. And they certainly have, even if they've edged close to that, avoided the July 4th, 1776 moment. That is a moment of Taiwan hereby declares independence as of this moment. That would not get a good international reaction from China or from much of any place else. So that's a major piece of the story. Coupled with that, to support that, have been a series of of measures to try to enhance Taiwan's participation in the international stage. The Most visible one recently, perhaps, has been Taiwan's attempt to maximize participation in international organizations. This means full membership in non-state member-only organizations where it can get in, things like APEC, the Asia-Pacific Economic Cooperation Group, the World Trade Organization, where you don't have to be a state to be in, and even there, Taiwan has had to accept some rather funky names that seem rather insulting to Taiwan, but that are the price of admission. Taiwan has also pursued, with less success, although with some, so-called meaningful participation in UN-affiliated organizations, but not the UN itself. So no hope for full membership, and no hope for the UN or in affiliated organizations, but some degree of access. So Taiwan was allowed to attend on an annual ad hoc basis the World Health Assembly, that's the plenary meetings of the members of the World Health Organization, for several years, for the years of the Ma Ying-jeou presidency when cross-strait relations were fairly good, and partly because of the sense that China had been so uncooperative or unsuccessful in cooperating with the world in handling the SARS epidemic in 2003, that it created sort of some moral standing and some political support for Taiwan to gain access. The COVID saga has not led to a repeat of that. That's partly about changes in China and partly about changes in China's view of Taiwan. There's a lot of Xi Jinping and Tsai Ing-wen to that story. Taiwan also got a one-off invitation during the Ma years to the International Civil Aviation Organization, another UN-affiliated body, to their triennial assembly, but only once. The second arrow in Taiwan's quiver on this front is to try to maintain formal diplomatic relations. Taiwan's shrinking fast, still in the double digits, but barely. And they're mostly small countries, mostly in places like the Caribbean and Oceania, not much left in Africa, not much left in Europe, just the Vatican. And so Beijing has squeezed Taiwan's formal diplomatic partners, and at some point Taiwan may have to abandon this strategy because the number will just get perilously small and perhaps close to zero. But for now, Taiwan will continue to do it because in addition to having a territory, a distinct people, an autonomous government, the capacity to engage in international relations, especially formal international relations, formal diplomatic relations, is one of the markers of statehood in the international system. So you'll see Taiwan continue to invest in this area, although it's a somewhat diminishing scheme. There's no magic number, so this could go on for some period of time. And if China squeezes Taiwan too hard, Taiwan can simply code switch and say, we're not going to talk informal diplomatic relations where, I said, we're not going to talk formal diplomatic relations where Taiwan is fairly weak, but talk informal relations where Taiwan is in much better shape. The bigger story in many ways is Taiwan's effort to maintain strong informal relations with great powers and even lesser powers, but especially with the United States. And here Taiwan scored some pretty big successes. During the Ma Ying-jeou years, U.S.-Taiwan relations recovered considerably from the stresses of the Chen Shui-bian years with the Wen Jiabao-Bush fireside chat, with the referendum on UN entry and that sort of thing. So they got to be a lot better, and under Tsai they have continued to be better and in some ways have gotten stronger, largely because of the dynamics in U.S.-China relations and the U.S. judgment of who is at fault for the deterioration in cross-strait relations recently. So we saw Trump go some distance in that direction, rattling China's cage and confidence about the U.S. commitment to the One China policy, and we've seen the Biden administration declare its support for Taiwan to be rock solid, and even if you screen out some perhaps loose statements by Biden at CNN town halls, the core U.S. position is clearly more supportive of Taiwan than we've seen in a good long time. And we've seen Congress get into the act in a way that is also something we have not seen. Congress passed the Taiwan Relations Act way back in 1979. There have been some minor amendments, but the story since then has been the repeated introduction of pro-Taiwan, Taiwan-supporting legislation in Congress, but it almost never passes. And now we've seen the Taipei Act, the provisions in the National Defense Authorizations Act, the Taiwan Travel Act, and many others, all of which don't really require the president to do all that much, and if they purported to, the president would push back on separation of powers grounds, but they clearly signal strong congressional support, bipartisan support. These things are passing with near unanimous approval, that basically Taiwan should be supported with closer defense cooperation, support for Taiwan's participation in international organizations, and sanctions against or reward against those who abandon Taiwan in the diplomatic relations game, and rewards to those who continue to back it, even though the U.S., of course, does not have formal relations. The final pair of arrows in Taiwan's quiver on this, the final strands in their international strategy, are essentially conformity to international norms. This is partly a soft power story and partly what I call as-if participation. And here the idea is that Taiwan enhances its international status by stressing its commitment to democracy, human rights, other liberal values, and the general international order, the rules-based international order, as we now call it, that it's a good citizen in that sense. And that's, I think, an understandable and somewhat promising strategy in the post-Cold War world in which we live. That is to say that in the old days, we used to view statehood and sovereignty as kind of an on-off switch. But especially in the post-Cold War breakup of the Soviet bloc, candidate new states were more likely to get accepted, more likely to get recognized, more likely to get full acceptance in the system if they adhered to the right values, as the West defined them, constitutional democracy, things like that. And states that were kind of rogue states weren't kicked out of the club, but they enjoyed somewhat less high ranking. North Korea, perhaps, rogue states, as we call them, and arguably China for its critics today. So that's the kind of soft power play, and you've seen Taiwan doing a lot of that through its COVID diplomacy and through its provision of humanitarian assistance and things of that ilk. The other sort of substrand here is that Taiwan, although not allowed to join many international organizations or to sign on to major UN-centered treaties, Taiwan behaves as if it were a party to those things that it cannot join. So it provides reports on implementation of the International Covenant of Civil and Political Rights and the International Covenant of Economic, Social, and Cultural Rights, just the way a party to that treaty would be. It stresses its commitments to the UN Convention on the Law of the Sea, even though it's not allowed to join it. It stresses its commitment to the climate change accords, the UNFCCC, and so on. And often that is done in pointed contrast to a critique of China falling short on those measures. So those have been the strategies. Why are things bad now? So things are bad now, I think, partly because the factors we've seen in the previous acts of this little play, the worsening cross-strait balance, the risk that Taiwan will be backed into a corner strategically and therefore may lash out is creating some stresses. There's sort of a U-curve of U.S.-China relations and Taiwan's security. When U.S.-China relations are too good or too bad, that's worse for Taiwan than in the middle, and now we're headed toward the too bad end, so Taiwan can be caught in the middle, as it were, or be a tempting target. There's a bit of a vicious circle in the recent moves that the U.S. and China have undertaken to address the Taiwan question. That is, the U.S. views China as being aggressive or assertive, so it tries to get its allies more on board with supporting Taiwan. China views that as an encirclement campaign and an intervention of a more serious multilateral sort in China's internal affairs, and so each side sees what it's doing as benign and what the other side is doing as malign, and that creates something of a spiral risk. And there is a problem, a concern, that Taiwan's domestic politics complicate matters here. Taiwan is a democracy, and there's no constituency for seeking a crisis, but there's certainly not much of a constituency for getting closer to China. And anytime you get into an election campaign, there's a temptation to play to the base, and there's a concern that the DPP, the current ruling party, may play to the so-called pro-independence base in a close election. So finally, since I know I'm almost up against time here, I'm going to hit the one-slide version of Act 5 here, which is something that draws together strands I've been talking about earlier, but I think is kind of a more synthetic, sort of broader nature of the game story. And here's where I think a lot of our current crisis and risk of, or current tensions and risk of real crisis come from. There's the domestic politics of U.S.-China relations. in both countries, both the U.S. and China. These are a much bigger source of friction and conflict than has been true in the recent past. There's a bipartisan consensus in the U.S. that we need to be tough on China, and a contest by each party to outdo the other in being tough on China. And on the Chinese side, you see Chinese nationalism. The sense that China should be stand up, should be strong, and getting back Taiwan is part of that. And China is, frankly, under Xi Jinping, less interested in, less concerned about, less vulnerable to foreign criticism and pressure. Secondly, there is a changing international relations dynamics that create a growing risk of misperception. The relative power of the U.S. and China are shifting, but in complex ways. And there is a risk that China will overestimate its leverage, its clout, its capacity, and that China may underestimate the U.S. resolve, and of course, vice versa. The U.S. may underestimate China's willingness to incur costs to try to get Taiwan back, and the U.S. may overestimate its ability to deter or persuade China. And the security dilemma of each side thinks it's doing a benign thing, protecting its core interests, and the other side's belief that the other side is, in fact, the aggressor, is I think, becoming a more significant dynamic. So do we see China as assertive, trying to squeeze Taiwan, trying to change the international status quo? Or is China, as China says, merely defending its core interests? Is the U.S. balancing an assertive China or trying to encircle and keep down a China which is simply trying to get back its rightful place? Is the U.S. attempting to preserve and protect universal values like human rights and democracy and protect its own national interests in the Western Pacific? Or is it meddling in China's internal affairs, trying to keep China down and trying to attempt to dictate to China how it should govern its own affairs in Taiwan and, for that matter, in the mainland? All of those issues are long present, but I think they've become sharper now. And finally, the conflict has moved into the gray zone. A lot of this past history was based on a scenario where it was a matter of deterring Taiwan from declaring formal independence and deterring China from using force in essentially an invasion scenario. Now it's much more complicated. The forms of coercion are in what national security types call the gray zones, and it's hard to draw red lines in the gray zones. So when you've got ships circling, planes crossing the ADIZ, doing all these things that come up to the edge of conflict but don't quite go there, what crosses the line? What do you push back against? What do you tolerate? And conflict has moved into the gray zone in another way. It's moved into political warfare or sharp power, including Chinese netizens or actually agents of the state engaging in sharp power attempts to sow division in Taiwan's electoral politics and to some degree even in U.S. electoral politics, which of course takes up the temperature. And how do you push back against that? Where is a red line crossed? It's not like a flat-out invasion. So that's all kind of bleak, and I'll close by saying that's all bad, but don't despair. It's not a destined for war scenario between the U.S. and China, whether over Taiwan or over something else. The most likely cause of great power conflict between the U.S. and China is indeed Taiwan, but it's still not a very likely cause. And China and the U.S. and Taiwan, at least at this point, all still recognize how costly crossing the line would be. There are risks, but they're risks mostly of misperception, of accidental spiral, of an incident that somehow gets out of control. And those are real concerns, especially since among the many distinctions between U.S.-China relations today and the Cold War, there are a lot of good distinctions. We're economically interdependent. We're not really ideologically hostile. We're not engaged in contests over territory with the arguable partial exception of Taiwan. But we don't have great crisis management mechanisms. We don't have great crisis communications arrangements as we did with the Soviet Union. So again, somewhat bleak, not desperate. I'll stop and take your questions and comments. Thanks.